Hey, welcome back to thecloudchurch.org, where we have a new sermon every week in English and Spanish. And today's sermon is on the subject of the kingdom of God versus the kingdom of heaven. I have a lot of people that have been emailing me lately and asking me, would you please preach on that? Because they say, I don't know the difference. Other people, most of Christianity today, doesn't think there's a difference. I've talked to many people and I've looked into many different denominations and what they teach on this subject. And many of them don't know anything about this subject, and quite a few of them, if not all of them, teach that the kingdom of God and the kingdom of heaven is the same thing. There's no difference between the two. They're both the same. But is that what the Bible teaches? Is there a difference? Is it right to teach that they're the same thing? Or, in fact, are they two different things? Well, they're definitely not spelled the same. You've got the kingdom of God, that's one thing, the kingdom of heaven. So it sounds like there's two different ones because there are two different words to describe them. So what does the Bible say about this? Now, I cannot emphasize how important this message is. This is probably one of the most important messages that you get a hold of as a Christian. Because this shows how to rightly divide the word of truth. 2 Timothy 2:15 tells us, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. There are some divisions that are to be made as you study the Bible. Because all the Bible is written for us to read, but not all the Bible is written to us. There's parts of this Bible that apply to years and years ago to a certain group. There are parts of this Bible that God gave us today for our doctrine. And we're going to look at that. And so we are not under that Old Testament law according to the Scriptures. I've got a message on YouTube about that, the difference between law and grace. How today we're under salvation by grace through faith and not works. But yet in the Old Testament, there were some works involved. There were some things that a person had to do under the law. Well, Christ is the end of the law to all who believe, Romans 10 and verse 4. Romans chapter 7 even says, we are dead to the law that we may be married to another, even to him who rose from the dead, Jesus Christ. So we're not married to the law. We're not under the law for salvation. We don't have to follow the law to get to heaven. We get to heaven through Jesus Christ and his death, burial, and resurrection for us. So, now let's look at this. What is this kingdom, the two kingdoms? Are there two kingdoms, or is there just one, as many people say? So what I did is I went through every verse in the Bible that talked about the kingdom of heaven, and in my computer I typed in kingdom of God and found every verse that uses the term kingdom of God. And granted, there are some places in which Jesus says in one gospel, the kingdom of God is like this, and in another gospel he says the same thing, but he substitutes kingdom of heaven. And for that reason, people say, see, they're the same thing. No, no, they're not. And the Bible is very plain and very clear that they're not the same thing, but yet they could have come at the exact same time. Both of these kingdoms could have come at the same time. But it was all based upon what a certain group did, whether or not one of these kingdoms came or the other. And we will see that as we get into this message. And I just cannot stress enough the importance of this message. It's something that you must learn in order to read and study and understand the Bible so you don't get confused, so you don't get into false doctrine and false error. That's why it's so important to understand this message. So I looked up the kingdom of heaven, and the kingdom of heaven appears 33 times in 32 verses in the King James Bible. And I thought, well, that's interesting. What I'll do is, so it's easy to understand, this I'll call the KOG, and this over here I'll call the KOH. And that way I can abbreviate and not have to write out the entire thing. So 33 times, oops, did I write that right? The kingdom of heaven. 33 times. It got cold here in Florida and my voice is going out a little bit, so I hope I can finish this up. So the kingdom of heaven shows up 33 times in the King James Bible. Does that mean anything? That's an interesting thing. Kingdom of God appears 70 times. So we've got the kingdom of God and the kingdom of heaven being mentioned in the Scriptures. Okay, so now, is there a difference? Like I said earlier, many people say, oh, there's no difference. But is there a difference? Well, I've gone through each time of this 70 times, and I've gone through each time of this 33 times and looked up what the Bible says about each. And you know what? There is a difference. There's definitely a difference. Now let me go ahead and write the Bible up here, and I'm going to present that to you today, the difference between the kingdom of God and the kingdom of heaven. And it's so, so important that you understand this difference. I just, you'll see by the end of this message just how important is the difference between the kingdom of God and the kingdom of heaven. All right, so here's the New Testament. Here's the rapture of the church. Here's that seven-year period called the tribulation, and Jesus comes back at the Battle of Armageddon. And this period right over here is the time that the Bible calls the millennium. And I'll just abbreviate that. I believe there's two L's in it. So that's the millennium. Okay, so you have this Old Testament here called the Law. We are, as I said earlier, are no longer under the Law. We're under the New Testament. We're under grace, where salvation is by grace through faith. The dividing line, of course, is the cross, where the death of a testator is. I've got several videos about that in the past sermons on the Cloud Church, and talk about how you have to have the blood shed of Jesus Christ. And where the death of a testator is, there starts a New Testament. So we're no longer under that Old Testament. The death of the testator, the death of Jesus, started the New Testament. Now, the Bible teaches us that over here is the rapture, so let me go ahead and write that up there. I just want to get this thing clear in your mind so that you'll see the difference. And this over here will be Armageddon, when Jesus Christ returns at the Battle of Armageddon and sets up his thousand-year rule in the millennial kingdom. So what you have here is you have the Bible laid out in a way where we can understand it. Now, according to what the Bible teaches, we have Jesus' ministry here. There is something that took place. When Jesus started his ministry, he started with the early apostles. And those early apostles went out preaching in their earthly ministry. But according to the Bible, God changed from the apostles to the apostle Paul. And there was a change from Jews to Gentiles. And all this ties in with these two kingdoms. And it is so important that you understand that. So, early ministry after Christ died and was buried and rose again was Jews going to Jews. And then it changed to the Apostle Paul and salvation of Gentile people. I've got many videos on YouTube about all this. One of the best ones I find that a lot of people are watching and saying that they learned a lot from was my video entitled Jesus versus Paul. You can go to YouTube, type in my name, Robert Breaker, Jesus versus Paul. And it shows you the difference between Jesus' ministry and the ministry of Paul, and why Paul is in the Bible. So we have here the whole Bible laid out in such a way to where we rightly divide. We see the Old Testament and the New Testament. Now, where do the kingdoms fit in? Well, first of all, let's look at this kingdom. What I'm going to do is I'm going to look at this one first, the kingdom of God. Then we'll come back to this one, the kingdom of heaven, and look at it. What does the Bible say about the kingdom of God? Romans chapter 14 and verse 17 is probably the most important verse in the Bible to tell us what the kingdom of God is. It's like it's a definition of the kingdom of God. So without further ado, let's read Romans 14, 17. It says, "For the kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost." So the kingdom of God is not meat and drink. It's righteousness, joy, and peace in the Holy Ghost. So what does that say? Well, meat and drink, well, that would be a physical something that you eat. It's something physical. And joy, peace, and righteousness, well, that's something spiritual. So what it is the kingdom of God is a spiritual kingdom, not a physical kingdom. And what we're going to see is the kingdom of heaven is a physical kingdom on the earth. So this kingdom of God is not meat and drink. What is it called? Well, the kingdom of God is called righteousness, joy, well, I'm running out of marker here, and peace. And notice that it says, so importantly, it's in the Holy Ghost. So it's being in the Holy Spirit, or really it's the Holy Spirit being in you, as we shall soon see. So this is a definition of the kingdom of God. It's a spiritual kingdom of righteousness, peace, and joy. Now, we go to Luke chapter 17, and we also find out more about this kingdom. Luke chapter 17 and verse 21, the Bible tells us this about the kingdom of God. Luke 17, 21, it says here, well, actually, let me back up to verse 20. Verse 20 has some interesting things in it as well. "And when he was demanded of the Pharisees when the kingdom of God should come, he answered them and said, the kingdom of God cometh not with observation." Now listen to that. You can't observe it. You can't see with your eyes the coming of the kingdom of God. It's something that comes and you just don't see it. More proof that it's a spiritual kingdom. Now look what he says. Jesus Christ speaking in verse 21. Neither shall they say, lo here or lo there, for behold, the kingdom of God is within you. Now, without a doubt, these two scriptures, Luke 17:21 and Romans 14 and verse 17, I'm going to go ahead and just write those up here. Romans 14:17 and Luke, oh, I forgot what it was again, Luke 17:21, tell us without a doubt that this kingdom of God is within you. So it's a spiritual kingdom, but it's a kingdom within the hearts of men. So the kingdom of God is a spiritual kingdom. And it's something that's within us, according to the scriptures, according to the word of God. So where would that correspond up here on this board? We've looked at the rightly dividing between the Old Testament and the New Testament. So where would the kingdom of God be? What is it? Well, it's a kingdom of God. Let's look at John chapter 3 and verse 3 real quick. John 3:3 and John 3:6, when Jesus is speaking, and this is a famous passage. Passage about you must be born again. And look what Jesus says in verse 3. John 3:3. Jesus answered and said unto him, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see what? Excuse me. The kingdom of God. And then it says here in verse 6, that which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the spirit is spirit. Verse 7, marvel not that I said unto thee, ye must be born again. Now let me back up to verse 5. Jesus answered, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. Now some people say, well, see, the water is the baptism. Oh, wait a minute. Verse 6, that which is born of the flesh is flesh, that which is born of the spirit is spirit. Your first birth is a birth of water. Woman has a baby right before she says, oh, my water broke. So you come out of the flesh the first time through the water. You're born of flesh, a water birth. You come out of a placenta full of water. The second time you're born, it's a spiritual birth, born again with the Holy Spirit of God. So this first kingdom, the kingdom of God, is a spiritual kingdom, and it's a kingdom within you, and it's a new birth. So the kingdom of God would fit where? After Jesus Christ rose from the dead, people began to get the Holy Spirit. And those that got the Holy Spirit were saved. So that must mean that this is where the kingdom of God fits. So this is the kingdom of God, that spiritual kingdom within you. Now these early people that got saved were Jews, and they got the Holy Spirit differently than the Gentiles do. I don't have time to go through the book of Acts and look at that transitional book. But when they did get the Holy Spirit, these Jews received the Holy Spirit of God. Now today, how do we receive the Holy Spirit? Well today, through the writings of Paul, we receive the Holy Spirit according to Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 13. So let's go to Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 13. Look at what the Bible says. People say, you say that verse a lot. Yeah, because it's so important. There are people today that don't rightly divide the word of truth. So they try to go back here the way the Jews got the Spirit and say, you got to get it that way, speak in tongues and do all this. But if you read the book of Acts, you see the transition to Gentiles, and that's not how we Gentiles get the Holy Spirit. We receive the Holy Spirit through trusting the gospel. The moment we believe, we receive the Holy Spirit of God. So in Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 13, we read, in whom ye also trusted, after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also after that ye believed, ye were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. So we today, we are sealed with the Holy Spirit. That means the Holy Spirit is within us. So if you're saved today by trusting the gospel of salvation, then you have the Holy Spirit within you, and you're a part of the kingdom of God. But does that make sense? So the kingdom of God starts after Jesus Christ had rose again. It's a kingdom where people are saved and receive the Holy Spirit of God. And it's a spiritual kingdom. It's not meat and drink, but righteousness and joy and peace in the Holy Ghost. Now let me read some verses quickly from Acts to show you this. Acts chapter 1, verse 3. To whom also he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of, doesn't say heaven, does it? When Jesus is in his earthly ministry, he's always talking about the kingdom of God, heaven, kingdom of heaven, kingdom of heaven. Very seldom does he talk about kingdom of God, but he does mention it sometimes. But over here, after Jesus died, all the way through the book of Acts, it doesn't mention the kingdom of heaven. It mentions kingdom of God, kingdom of God, kingdom of God, kingdom of God, kingdom of God. So obviously, this is the period of the kingdom of God. Many times, I'll just show you some verses through Acts. Over and over, as the early apostles are going and preaching, they're preaching kingdom of God. Acts chapter 8 and verse 12. But when they believed, Philip preaching the things concerning the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. Baptism after salvation, not to get saved. Acts 14:22. He says here in Acts, confirming the souls of the disciples and exhorting them to continue in the faith, and that we must through much tribulation enter into the kingdom of God. Well, the early church was persecuted. They went through a lot of tribulation, a lot of persecution. But they were saved into the kingdom of God. Acts chapter 20, verse 25. And the Bible says, and verse 24, this is in the context of the gospel of the grace of God. Paul's gospel, salvation. Verse 25, and now behold, I know that ye all, among whom I have gone preaching the kingdom of God, shall see my face no more. So the kingdom of God all ties into this time period that we today call the church age. When did the church start? Well, I've got a video about that. You can look at that. How Jesus Christ died to form himself a body. And this body that we today call the body of Christ all ties into the church age. So it's all there. It's all right there in your face. If you just read the Bible, it'll tell you what the kingdom of God is. Just two more verses real quick out of Acts. Acts chapter 28, verse 23. Acts 28, 23 says, and when they had appointed him a day, there came many to him. Who? Paul. Unto his lodging, to whom he expounded and testified the kingdom of God, persuading them concerning Jesus, both out of the law of Moses and out of the prophets, from morning till evening. So Paul was preaching about the kingdom of God and told them about the things in the scriptures pertaining to that. And you know, in the same chapter in verse 31, speaking of Paul, it says, preaching the kingdom of God and teaching those things which concern the Lord Jesus Christ with all confidence, no man forbidding him. So here we have Paul. God called Paul to be the apostle to the Gentiles, which we'll see here in a minute. So what is the kingdom of God? Go to Galatians chapter 5. You say, boy, you're really going through a lot of scriptures. Well, I just want you to see what I'm teaching is what the Bible says, not my opinion, not some denominational headquarters that says this is what you have to believe to be a member of our denomination or whatever. This is just what the Bible says if you read it. It makes a difference between the kingdom of God and kingdom of heaven, and it tells us what is the kingdom of God and what is the kingdom of heaven. Galatians chapter 5, verse 22 tells us, remember, the kingdom of heaven is within you. It's righteousness, joy, and peace. It's the Holy Ghost in you. It's a spiritual kingdom. Well, in this passage of Galatians chapter 5, verse 22, we have what's called the fruit of the Spirit. What is the fruit of the Spirit? Verse 22, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace. Well, this kingdom is joy, peace. It says long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith. Well, how do we get faith today? How do we get righteousness today? It's through faith. We're saved by grace through faith. So, and I won't continue to read there, except verse 25. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. So there is a spiritual kingdom that the only way to get into is to be born again. How do you get born again? By believing the gospel. When you trust the gospel of salvation, you are sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise, and the Holy Spirit comes within you, and you're part of the kingdom of God. That's just what the Bible teaches about it. When Jesus was here on earth, he mentioned it very little. Most of when Jesus was preaching, more often he spoke about the kingdom of heaven. And there's a reason for that, because when he was here, he was preaching to Jews. And that kingdom of heaven, as we shall shortly see, applies to Jews and the Jewish nation. And this kingdom of God applies to some Jews that got saved in the early part of the church, but it mostly applies to Gentiles. It's the church age period. It's all having to do with the body of Christ. Now, Matthew chapter 6 and verse 33, Jesus is speaking, and look what he says. This is interesting. Matthew 6:33, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. I like that. It says, seek ye first. So this kingdom, the kingdom of God, says that it's the first thing that you should seek. Well, if it says seek it first, doesn't that imply that there's something second that's coming up? Could it be that the first kingdom, the kingdom of God, is the first kingdom, and that after this kingdom, there's a second kingdom, the kingdom of heaven? No, they're the same, most Bible scholars say. There's no difference. Kingdom of God, kingdom of heaven are the same. Are they really? We're going to look at that and see if these Bible scholars really are telling you the truth, or maybe they're Bible ignoramuses that don't study the scriptures. Because as we read through the Bible, we find out that that other kingdom, the kingdom of heaven, is a kingdom that deals with the nation of Israel. Over here, the law dealt with Israel. And according to the law, there was going to be a time in the future, in this millennial kingdom, when Jesus was going to come and reign. And if you lived under that Old Testament law, you know what you were doing? You were reading that law, and you were reading that promise of a soon coming king. And you were looking for the Messiah, which is what Jesus was, but the Jews rejected him. And you were looking at him to come as the king of Israel who would reign on this earth. So when Jesus came as the Messiah, the Jews were thinking, good, finally, he's going to kick out the Jews and set up his kingdom here. But you know what they missed? All those prophecies in the Old Testament under the law and the prophets and Psalms and everything that applied to this future kingdom, they also had prophecies in it that applied to the suffering first. So Jesus suffered on the cross. You see, he couldn't receive his kingdom future until he first suffered. Now you get a chance, go to Cloud Church and look up my past sermon entitled The Two Comings of Jesus Christ. And I show that in the Bible, there are two different times that Jesus Christ comes. The first time he comes as a lamb. And you know, the first time Jesus comes, there's two parts of his coming. He comes and he's born of a virgin. So they have the virgin birth. That's the first coming. He dies. And then he comes back when he raises from the grave and visits these apostles for 40 days. So there's two parts of the first coming. But the first time Jesus Christ comes, he comes as a lamb to die for all the sins of everyone on the earth. The second time Jesus comes, he comes as a lion. He comes in anger. He comes in the Battle of Armageddon as the leader. And he wipes out his enemies on the battlefield of Armageddon. And he sets up his kingdom as king. So with that stated, guess what? What is the kingdom of heaven? Well, the kingdom of heaven is this over here. This is the kingdom of heaven. It's the millennial kingdom of Jesus Christ. So when Jesus Christ was here on the earth, and guess who it's for? It's for Israel. So when Jesus came, the Jews were thinking he was coming for this, to set up his kingdom here on earth. And he could have. Jesus Christ could have set up his kingdom back here, but he didn't, because he allowed those Jewish religious leaders to decide whether or not they wanted the kingdom to come or not. Let me just go into the scriptures to show you this, and you'll understand what I'm saying. Go to Mark chapter 10. Mark chapter 10, again, the kingdom of God, the spiritual kingdom. The kingdom of heaven, therefore, would be the physical kingdom. So this is the physical kingdom in which Jesus physically, literally, bodily comes to this world and rules and reigns on the earth. Mark chapter 10, I'm going to start reading verse 5 all the way down to verse 7. And you tell me if you see a spiritual kingdom here. Mark chapter 10, verse 5, verse 5 through 7, excuse me. Matthew chapter 10, verse 5 through 7. And Matthew chapter 10, verse 5 through 7 says right here. Now notice this. These 12 Jesus sent forth and commanded them, saying, go not into the way of the Gentiles, and into any city of the Samaritans enter ye not. But go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And as ye go, preach, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Now what does it mean that it's at hand? It means it can come to pass right now. But who is it for? Here in Jesus' ministry, Jesus Christ says, go to the Jews, Israel. Only to the Jews, not to the Gentiles. Don't go to these people. Go only to the Jews, Israel. And tell them that the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Other places it says has come near. So the kingdom of heaven was very, very near during that time. In fact, it could have been set up as Jesus in the millennial kingdom. But there's something that took place that postponed the kingdom of heaven. But notice in that passage that it is to the house of Israel. And he says in verse 7, "And as you go, preach, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand." So God told his disciples, preach only to Jews the kingdom of heaven. And tell them that it's close, it's coming, it's at hand. That it could come right there. Did it come? Well, let's go to Matthew chapter 3 and verse 2. Matthew chapter 3 and verse 2. Here we have a man named John the Baptist. And John the Baptist is preaching. And in chapter 3 and verse 2 of Matthew, we read these words. And saying, "Repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." So John the Baptist was even saying, the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of heaven, and the kingdom of heaven. So we have old John the Baptist back here. And he was preaching, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Jesus preaching, kingdom of heaven is at hand. Told his disciples, preach, that the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Now, John chapter 12, verse 13. All those Old Testament prophecies, many of them dealt with the future king of Israel. So when Jesus Christ came and they saw that he was the Messiah, many of the people of Israel said, well, he must be here to set up his kingdom. And so they were expecting him to come in as king and to kick out Pilate, kick out Herod, kick out Rome, and set up his kingdom in Jerusalem right then. And as you read through the Gospels, you know what you find? That mindset is there, and that they actually fulfill it by going before Jesus and putting down these palm tree leaves. And look what they say in John 12, 13, in the triumphal entry of Jesus Christ into Jerusalem in his day. John 12, 13 says, well, let me start in verse 12. "On the next day, much people that were come to the feast, when they heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem, took branches of palm trees and went forth to meet him and cried, Hosanna, blessed is the King." Notice what it says. The King of Israel. So they're saying, he is our King. He's our Messiah. He's the one that's come to set up a kingdom. "That cometh in the name of the Lord." Now, Mark chapter 11. Further evidence of this is found in the scriptures that their mindset, the Jewish mindset, was a kingdom and a king we want to rule over us. We are tired of having Rome rule over us. We want the Messiah, the promised King of Israel, to come now. Mark chapter 11, verse 9 through 10, notice what it says. "And they that went before and they that followed cried," okay, "saying, Hosanna, blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Blessed be the kingdom of our father David that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." So this is a kingdom. The Jews said that when Jesus comes, or whoever the Messiah was, they didn't know it was Jesus, but that he would set up the kingdom. And that's what this is, this millennial thousand-year rule of which Jesus will literally rule for 1,000 years on the earth. This will be that kingdom. And according to the Bible, this is the kingdom of heaven. Notice the difference. The kingdom of God is a spiritual kingdom where it's within you. When you're saved, you receive Jesus and he rules in your heart. But there will be a time that's a physical kingdom in which Jesus Christ will literally rule and reign on this earth for 1,000 years. So you have two distinct, very different kingdoms in the Bible. That's why they have two different names. One's called the kingdom of God, the one that's within you, that's righteousness, joy, and peace, that's not meat and drink and the Holy Ghost. It's not something that you can see outwardly. It's inward. And the other is the kingdom of heaven, which is outward, which everyone will see when Jesus comes and rules and reigns on this earth for 1,000 years. The millennial kingdom of Jesus Christ. This, by the way, is for Jews. This one over here is for Jews and Gentiles alike. It's the body of Christ. So two completely different kingdoms. Now, when it started here with these early apostles and Peter, you know what the Bible teaches is that this right here could have been the start of the kingdom of heaven had the Jewish leaders accepted their Messiah. But they rejected their Messiah. So the Jews thought that Jesus would be king then and set up his kingdom in Jerusalem and kick Rome out. That's what they were waiting for. Why were they waiting for that? Why did they think that? Well, because the Bible tells us that when Jesus came, he preached that. So what did Jesus preach? Go to Matthew chapter 4. I'm going to show you a couple of verses of what Jesus Christ was preaching while he was on this earth. Because he came preaching about this kingdom. Telling them, this is what this kingdom over here, the millennial kingdom, will be like. So there was an opportunity that that kingdom came in. But as we'll see in a minute, it was postponed because they rejected their Messiah. And in Matthew chapter 4, verse 7, Jesus is preaching, and look at what he's preaching. Matthew 4, 7. Well, a lot of times I do that. I leave out a number. Matthew 4, 17, excuse me. So Matthew chapter 4, verse 17 says, "From that time Jesus began to preach and to say, 'Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand.'" So Jesus in his earthly ministry, a Jew preaching to Jews, told Jews, "Repent, for this kingdom is at hand." So repent and get ready, because this kingdom over here is about to come. Unless something takes place first, and it has to be postponed. Matthew chapter 5 and verse 3. Jesus is preaching in the Beatitudes. "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of" what? "Kingdom of heaven." Matthew chapter 5 and verse 10. Jesus is preaching. "Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of" what? "Heaven." Well, there were some Jews persecuted here for the sake of Christ. And had the Jewish nation accepted their Messiah, that kingdom could have started right there. But because the Jewish leaders as a whole rejected it, it was postponed and put out here. And guess what? There'll be some Jews in the tribulation that are persecuted under the Antichrist before this kingdom comes. Matthew 5:19, Jesus again speaking, "Whosoever therefore shall break one of these least commandments and shall teach men so, he shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But whosoever shall do and teach them, the same shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven." But wait a minute, Jesus is telling people that you keep the works of the law and you'll be great in this kingdom. But everything that Paul wrote was, you're not saved by works. So you see, Jesus must have been Jew preaching to Jews about this. And because the Jews as a nation rejected, God said, "Paul, I'm going to start a different dispensation and a different kingdom. And then this kingdom will be until the time of the Gentiles be fulfilled. And then this kingdom will be the one in which Jesus comes back for the Jews." Chapter 5, verse 20. Look at what Jesus says. "For I say unto you that except your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, ye shall in no case enter into the kingdom of heaven." Here's a warning. The warning is, don't be like the Pharisees. Who were they? They were lost religious leaders who persecuted those that believed the truth, who lied, who stole from people, who were sinners exceedingly and were hypocrites according to Jesus Christ. And he says, your righteousness has to exceed their righteousness, the righteousness of the Pharisees that lived in this time. And if your righteousness was good enough, then you got into this kingdom over here. Well, how do we get into this kingdom? Is it by our own righteousness? Oh, do we do good and then God comes inside of us and we're part of the kingdom of God? No. 1,000 times no. Jesus Christ was preached by Paul as our righteousness. Paul preached that our righteousness is imputed to us through Christ. So back here, under the law, you had to do good, and by your own righteousness, you could get blessings. So over here is this kingdom. How do you get into that kingdom? By your own righteousness. Well, in the tribulation, the Bible says that they are the ones that have the testimony of Jesus Christ, and they keep the commandments of the Lord. So by their own righteousness, they're able to enter into this kingdom out here. Well, I know I went off the screen here, but hopefully you can read all that. So let's go to another place, another verse. Matthew chapter 8 and verse 11. Now watch this. You've got to rightly divide these two kingdoms to understand. Matthew chapter 8 and verse 11. Jesus says something very interesting about this kingdom. Matthew 8:11, Jesus says, "And I say unto you that many shall come from the east and west, and shall sit down with Abraham and Isaac and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven." Now wait a minute. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, well, they're dead. So how can anybody sit down with them in the kingdom? Are they here today, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob? Well, in this kingdom, this spiritual kingdom of the church age, they're not here. But the Bible says that in this millennial kingdom, that they can come back. In fact, Jesus Christ is going to let all those Old Testament Jews back into the land in a glorified body. And so in this kingdom, you can have Abraham, I'll just abbreviate him to Abe, you can have Isaac back in a glorified body, and Jacob, and they'll actually be able to be in the land with Jesus when he's reigning in the millennium. And guess what? Anybody who wants to can come and sit down and talk to them. Isn't that something? So when Jesus Christ came in his ministry, he came as a Jew to Jews. And he preached to those Jews this kingdom. He said, this kingdom is for you. And it's this kingdom out here. It's his millennial reign in which he rules. Now sometimes he mentioned this kingdom, because this kingdom could have been out here as well. They could have been together side by side. But there's something that happened in which God had to split up these two kingdoms. What is that that made these two kingdoms where they couldn't be together, they had to be split into two different kingdoms? Why can't they both be the same kingdom together? Why are they two different ones in two different time periods is the question. Well, that's pretty easy. Look at what it says in Matthew chapter 23. You see, everything was based upon whether or not the Jewish religious leaders accepted Jesus Christ. Had they accepted him, then he could have been the king of Israel right then. But he had to suffer first, and that's what the Jews didn't understand. What is this suffering? Why does he have to die? Well, he had to die for the sins of the whole world. And after he rose again from the dead, he allowed those Jews to go out and preach, and he told them, look, if you preach this, and those Jewish religious leaders repent and get saved, then I'm going to start this kingdom. But what we're about to find out is those Jewish religious hypocrite religious leaders said, we will not have this man. We reject him. And so God goes, okay, this is going to be way out here, and right here is going to be my kingdom, a spiritual kingdom of salvation. Some people call it the postponement theory, which is a great word for it, but actually it's the postponement fact, because the kingdom of heaven was postponed, this kingdom was postponed from here to out here, in order for God to have this kingdom here first. That's why the Bible says, seek ye first the kingdom of God, because it came first. And then comes the kingdom of heaven out here. Does that make sense? I hope you understand. If not, rewind this video and watch it all over. But look at what Jesus says to these religious Pharisees in Matthew chapter 23 and verse 13. Matthew 23, 13. But woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites! Now watch what Jesus says. It can't get any plainer than this. For ye shut up the kingdom of heaven against men, for ye neither go in yourselves, neither ye suffer them that are entering to go in. So in this time period, these Pharisees, these Sadducees, these religious leaders, were fighting against this kingdom coming. And he said, you bunch of hypocrites! You're shutting it up and closing the door on this kingdom so you won't go in. And you don't want people who are going into it to go in. If that's not proof that this kingdom was postponed, I don't know what is. Jesus from his own mouth says, you Pharisees, you religious leaders, are shutting the door on this kingdom. I could have come back, not only as the suffering lamb, but as the lion at the same time, but you rejected. So now I have to have a spiritual kingdom. And in the future, I'll come back to the earth. It's called the kingdom of heaven, but it's actually here on earth. It's called the kingdom of God, but it's the kingdom where God is within man, within you. So let's look at this rejection of Jesus Christ. As you go through the Bible, you find an interesting thing. You find three rejections of the Messiah by the Jews. I'm going to go ahead and write up here these three rejections. You know, in baseball, they say, strike three, you're out. Well, God gave them three chances. They rejected God the Father under the teaching of John the Baptist. They rejected God the Son when they crucified and killed Jesus Christ. And they rejected God the Holy Spirit when they stoned Stephen. And I'm going to show you that from the scripture. So you'll see the three times God gave those religious Pharisees three times to accept their Messiah. And they rejected their Messiah. The first one is in Matthew chapter 21. Look at verse 23 through 27. There we read. And when he was come into the temple, the chief priests and the elder of the people came unto him as he was teaching and said, By what authority doest thou these things? And who gave thee this authority? You see, that was a question because the Pharisees loved having the authority, and they didn't want anyone to rule over them and be their authority. Verse 24, Jesus answered and said unto them, I will also ask of you one thing, which if you tell me, I and likewise will tell you by what authority I do these things. The baptism of John, whence was it, from heaven or of man? And they reasoned within themselves, saying, If we say from heaven, he shall say to us, Why then did you not believe him? But if we shall say, Of men, we fear the people, for all hold John as a prophet. And they answered Jesus and said, We cannot tell. And he said unto them, Neither tell ye I you by what authority I do these things. God the Father sent John the Baptist as to cry in the wilderness. What was he? He was the one before Jesus to point people to Jesus Christ, even prophesied of in the Old Testament. And what he did is he called all Israel out and he said, You need to be baptized. Repent and be baptized. Why did he say that? Cleanse yourself because your Messiah is coming. Well, you read the Bible, all these old Pharisees came out and watched all these sinners getting dunked and baptized. And the Pharisees said, We're not sinners. And yet they were the most wicked, vile, ungodly, filthy people that ever lived. Yet their sins weren't outwardly, their sins were inwardly. And so rather than get baptized, as they were commanded by John the Baptist, sent from God the Father, they said, We're not going to do that. And they didn't. So they rejected God the Father and the baptism of John. Strike one. The next time, they rejected Jesus Christ. And all throughout the Gospels, you find that rejection is over and over and over. They're butting heads against Jesus. And they are the ones that had him crucified. And in Mark chapter 15, verse 11 through 14. But the chief priests moved the people that they should rather release Barabbas unto them. And Pilate answered and said again unto them, What will ye then that I shall do unto him whom you call the King of the Jews? And they cried out again, Crucify him! And what did they do? They crucified their Messiah. And then Pilate said unto them, Why? What evil hath he done? And they cried out the more, Exceedingly, crucify him. But it says in verse 11 that they moved the people. So these Pharisaical Jewish leaders fought against and killed God the Son, Jesus Christ. Strike two, Israel. You see, the leaders God held accountable for people of Israel. And they rejected it and moved the very same people that a few days before were laying out leaves and saying, Hail Hosanna, the King of Israel. Come on in and set up your kingdom. Those very same people, a few days later, said, Crucify him! Crucify him! And they killed the God of glory under the direction of those Jewish leaders. So strike two. Well, Jesus Christ died, but then he rose again the third day. And after he rose again, he appeared to his disciples and he preached a little bit. And then we get to the book of Acts. We find a guy named Stephen that had a little bit of courage. And Stephen went to those religious leaders and he stood up to them. And he said, I'm going to tell y'all something, you bunch of devils. You murdered your Messiah and you don't even care. And when you go to Acts chapter 7 and verse 51, look at what he says. He says, ye stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart, talking to the Pharisees and the Sadducees, ye do always resist the Holy Ghost as your fathers did, so do you. So do ye. So under the mighty preaching of Stephen, where he preached and proved beyond any shadow of a doubt that Jesus Christ was the Messiah, those religious leaders got so mad they said, kill him! And they picked up stones. You see, before when it was Jesus, they didn't want to get their hands dirty. Oh, we'll let the Romans kill him. And then they could say, see, the Romans killed him. We didn't do it. But they were so vile and wicked and evil in their heart when it came to Stephen, they themselves picked up and started throwing the rocks. Because they did not want to admit that they were wrong. So three times they rejected God. Three times they rejected the Messiah. And that's when God says, okay, I'm going to bring this kingdom rather than this one. And so God set up the kingdom of God and allowed it to go to Gentiles. Kingdom of God, I believe, started with Jesus Christ. But he said, now I'm going to let it go to Gentiles. And so that's when Paul was called. Acts chapter 8, the very next chapter, Ethiopian eunuch gets saved. Chapter 9, Paul is called by God. Chapter 10 and 11, old Peter, God tells him to go preach to Gentiles. Why would God tell him to go preach to Gentiles? Because he's done with the Jews. because he's done with them, and this kingdom, he says, is going to be way out there now because they rejected me. I'm going to go to this people, the people that the Jews hate, and for envy, show them, hey, these guys are going to get saved because you guys could have been saved and you rejected him. And that's what happened. So, God's dealing with Gentiles now through Paul and his gospel. What is the gospel? Well, God told Paul that the gospel is this, 1 Corinthians 15, verses 1 through 4. And the gospel is that Christ Jesus died for our sins, was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures. And if you want to be saved, the only way to be saved today is through this gospel. And God is dealing with Gentiles now. Now, that doesn't mean Jews can't be saved. Individually, Jews can be saved today, but they must come through this gospel for salvation. And so that's what the Bible teaches, is that this kingdom of heaven that Jesus preached about all the time could have been here. But because the Jews rejected, it was postponed out here. And so today, we who are saved are in the kingdom of God. Out there will be the kingdom of heaven. I hope you can still read that. I know I went way far over, but I think you can still read all that. Let me show you another thing. Romans chapter 11 and verse 25. Romans 11, 25. This is such an important message. Do you see why? I was raised in Southern Baptist churches most of my life. And I just remember every single service, these deacons would get up and they'd always stand up front by the table with their little offering plate. And the pastor would say, Deacon so-and-so, would you pray? And he'd bow his head and pray, Dear Lord. And then at the end of the prayer, every single service, I don't care which deacon it was, every single one said, Lord, thy kingdom come and thy will be done. Amen. And I'm thinking to myself, what? Thy kingdom come? Why are they praying that this would come if that's for Jews? His kingdom is already here for us who are saved. We're in that kingdom, the kingdom of God. Why would you be praying that another kingdom come? By the way, that prayer, Thy Kingdom Come, is a prayer that Jesus told His disciples to pray. Look at that. That's in Matthew chapter 6. Jesus says, and He's talking to His disciples, and He says, they were like, how should we pray, Lord? And God says in Matthew 6, 10, well actually 9, After this manner therefore pray ye, Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Thy kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. This is Jesus Christ, a Jew, speaking to the Jews, telling them this is a prayer to pray for this. It's not a prayer that we pray today, because His kingdom has come for us. Because if we're saved, we have the Holy Spirit inside. Do you see the mess that people get in when they don't understand this? People go to Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Well, I'm sorry, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John are all before the cross until Jesus Christ dies. So Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, these three books, or four books, are really all Old Testament until Jesus actually dies in those books. So that means you can't take anything in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John and try to apply it to us today, except for what he says, you must be born again, except unless it's talking about the kingdom of God. So when they say, this is how you pray, thy kingdom come, it's telling Jews to pray for this kingdom. It's Jesus, a Jew, talking to Jews. So why are Christians praying, oh God, forgive me of my sins? What? When you're in this kingdom, your sins are forgiven. Why, it's a slap in the face of Jesus to ask Him to forgive your sins if you're already saved, because He already did. Do you realize to ask Jesus to forgive your sins is to ask Jesus to die on the cross all over again? That's what it is. Either His death, burial, and resurrection paid for all your sins, or it paid for all of them until you sin, and then when you sin again, you have to say, oh God, forgive me. Well, what would He have to do to forgive you then? He'd have to go die again. Either that took care of all sins, or it didn't. If it didn't, then Jesus is going to have to die for the new ones that you do over and over. That's ridiculous. Jesus Christ died for all sins, past, present, and future. And we as Christians don't pray, oh God, forgive us our sins. If we're saved, we know our sins are forgiven through the blood of Jesus Christ. So what do we do? Well, we say, Lord, I did such and such, and I'm sorry. I hate it. I hate it, Lord, and I'm sorry that I did that evil sin. That's something that you should do. You should confess your sins and tell God how sorry you are for them. But then you don't say, now please forgive me. If you're saved, you already know you're forgiven. You just feel bad about it. That's why you're confessing it, because you're saying, Lord, I'm sorry I did that. But you don't have to ask him to save you all over again. You're either saved or you're not. A lot of Christians don't understand that. So Romans chapter 11, look at what Paul, our apostle, tells us. I know I had some more verses here in Romans somewhere. There it is. Let's go to Romans 11, verse 13. For I speak to you Gentiles, and as much as I am apostle to the Gentiles, I magnify my office. Our apostle is Paul today. See how important it is to rightly divide the word of truth? The biggest so-called Christian church in the world today says, no, Paul's nobody. We started with Peter, and we say he's the foundation of our church. And they're wrong. And you know what? That same church that founds on Peter, and for those of you that don't know, it's the Roman Catholic Church. That church that wants to follow Peter rather than Paul believes that they are in the kingdom of heaven right now. And that church believes that they can do anything they want physically. That's why you had a thing called the Crusades, in which that church went out and killed millions of Muslims and murdered millions of true Christians who followed Paul as their apostle in the Spanish Inquisition and other things. They didn't get their kingdoms right. They say, oh, well, Jesus said in Matthew that God's going to give the keys of the kingdom to Peter. Well, the Bible says they gave him two keys. God said to Peter, here's two keys. What does that mean? The first key was for this kingdom, for the Jews to accept. And Peter went out preaching the kingdom of heaven. And you know what? The Jews rejected it, so that key didn't open the door. So then God told Paul, here's what I want you to do, Paul, start preaching this. And the Bible says that Paul went and talked to Peter and told him about what God revealed unto him. And guess what? That door was opened. A great and effectual door is opened unto me, Paul says, to the Gentiles. So there was a key given to Peter to open the kingdom of heaven. And if those Jewish leaders would have accepted it, it would have been open and that kingdom of heaven would have started back here. But it wasn't. It was shut. And the Pharisees are the one that shut it up, according to Jesus Christ. So that same key God gave to Peter, Peter went out in Acts chapter 10 and preached to Gentiles. And God told Peter, see now, it's all about preaching to Gentiles, Peter, because the Jews rejected me. And so what? He started preaching the kingdom of heaven, old Peter did, sure did, until that door was shut by the rejection of their Messiah. So now we're in the kingdom of God. Acts chapter 13, look at verse 46. When you understand this, oh, it opens the Bible up and makes it such an awesome thing to understand. Because most people don't read the Bible because they say, I don't understand it. But when you understand it, it makes you want to read it more. Because it's so fascinating how God did all of this. Acts chapter 13 and verse 46. Then Paul and Barnabas waxed bold and said, now who are they speaking to? Well, the Bible says in verse 45, they're speaking to Jews. So look at what Paul says to Jews. It was necessary that the word of God should first have been spoken to you, Jews, with Jesus' ministry and with the early apostles preaching to Jews. And then look at what he says here. But seeing ye put it from you and judge yourselves unworthy of everlasting life, lo, we turn to the Gentiles. So first to you, the Jews, you could have accepted the Messiah and have that kingdom of heaven come in, where Jesus literally was on earth reigning. But because you turned it down and judged yourself unworthy, we're going to go to the Gentiles. And God changed from the kingdom of heaven could have been here to a postponement of the kingdom of heaven so that the kingdom of God would be taking place here. It could have happened at the same time. Romans chapter 15 and verse 16. Romans 15, 16. Paul says, that I should be the minister of Jesus Christ to the Gentiles, ministering the gospel of God, that the offering up of the Gentiles might be acceptable, being sanctified by the Holy Ghost. So Paul preached the gospel of God and preached about the kingdom of God. And he preached salvation by trusting the blood of Jesus Christ, trusting the gospel, the death, burial, resurrection. And when you're saved, you're sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. And when you're sealed, you're in the kingdom of God. Because he is within you. Close this up with Romans chapter 11. I sure hope you understood this. This is something that you've got to get. So few Christians know this stuff. I count myself blessed to have gone to a Bible school in which they taught this. But I don't believe it because they taught me. I believe it because the Bible says it's true. I find it in the Scriptures. It's great that they knew it and taught it. But they didn't teach it and just pull it out of left field. They taught the Bible. So the Bible teaches these two kingdoms, not just one. Now, what's going to happen at the end of the kingdom of God? We're supposed to seek ye first the kingdom of God. Well, we seek it and we're in it. Well, the Bible teaches that the rapture of the church will come. And I believe that's going to be really soon. When that rapture of the church takes place, there's going to be a time in which God goes back to dealing with Israel in the tribulation. And that also will be a time in which God will come back, destroy the Antichrist at Armageddon, and when he does, he's going to set up the kingdom of God here on earth. So the kingdom of God is now, kingdom of heaven here on earth. The kingdom of God is now, and God's dealing with Gentiles and Jews through the gospel. But as a nation, God will go back to dealing with them as soon as the rapture's over, and this kingdom, the kingdom of heaven, will come soon. And the Bible tells us that. And why is that important? Because there's a certain guy on YouTube preaching, oh, God's done with the Jews. There's no such thing as Jews anymore. There's no Jews. Well, then what's the kingdom of heaven even for then? There must be Jews in order for God to come back and reign over them. In Romans chapter 11, verse 25 says, for I would not, brethren, that ye should be ignorant of this mystery, lest ye should be wise in your own conceits, that blindness in part has happened to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles be come in. Then verse 26 says, and so all Israel shall be saved. As it is written, there shall come out of Zion the deliverer, and shall turn away ungodliness for Jacob. So, Israel as a nation isn't saved today. They're still waiting for that future kingdom, that physical kingdom of Jesus Christ. Today we're under this kingdom, but blindness in part has happened to Israel. So they're blind right now, they don't see their Messiah. But over here in the tribulation, the book of Revelation tells us they will see their Messiah. There's going to be two witnesses show up over here in this time. There's going to be, there's going to be 144,000 other witnesses that are going to show up. And guess what they're going to do? They're going to tell those Jews, hey, you killed your Messiah, and you could have had all this back here. But you missed it. So guess what? Trust Jesus now so he can come back. Well, there's the message. I hope it was clear. I hope it was plain. What do you do with those guys that say, oh, they're the same thing? Are they really? I mean, all I've done is show you the verses. The kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but righteousness, joy, and peace in the Holy Ghost. It's a spiritual kingdom within you. And it applies to the church age, the body of Christ. Now, what is the kingdom of heaven? Why, it's the gospel of the kingdom that Jesus Christ preached to the Jews in his earthly ministry. It's the gospel that he told the early apostles to preach as they went only to Jews. But they slammed the door. They said, we don't want this door open. And so God says, now I'm going to go to Gentiles. And what a blessing that we can be saved today as Gentiles and receive and be sealed with the Holy Spirit by faith in the gospel of Jesus Christ. But as soon as this church age is over, as soon as the rapture takes place, God goes back to dealing with Israel. He's going to send some witnesses. He's going to say, look, I was the Messiah. And they're going to wake up. They're going to see that. Many of them are going to turn to Jesus Christ. You might be a Jew watching this and you might laugh. I'll never turn to Jesus Christ. You will then. Because there'll be so many signs. You can't deny it. Then Jesus will come at the Battle of Armageddon, and then he'll set up the physical kingdom of heaven. So obviously there's two distinct, very different kingdoms. One is the earthly kingdom over here. One is the spiritual kingdom over here. So I appreciate you watching. I hope this helps you as you read the Bible to understand what Jesus is speaking about. I hope you see the difference between the kingdom of God and the kingdom of heaven. And I hope you'll take this message, maybe share it with others, help others to see, because look what it does. It really opens our eyes up. And I forgot to mention this. The most important thing it does is show us that the Bible is written for us, but specifically, these books, Romans through Philemon, are church-age doctrine. And what I've found in my years in the ministry is many, many churches, all they want to do is spend their time in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John and try to apply that to the church today when that was written in the Old Testament to these Jews and these Jewish people about their kingdom. Why don't they ever preach from Romans, 1st and 2nd Corinthians, 1st and 2nd Thessalonians, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians? Why don't they ever preach that? Because that's for us today. It's so sad. Well, I appreciate you watching, and I forgot to say this. If you're lost, why don't you come to Jesus Christ? Trust Him as your Savior. So easy to be saved. It's simply by faith, trusting in the death, burial, and resurrection, trusting the gospel, 1 Corinthians 15, verses 1 through 4. We'll see you back next time on thecloudchurch.org. I'm Robert Breaker. Thanks for watching.